Okay, time now to pivot from a Russian ambassador to an American one. Ryan Crocker is one of this country's most accomplished diplomats. In fact, he's got another one of those CVs that is enough to make you want to quit whatever job you have and just go home and curl up on the couch, because you're never going to compete. If you don't believe me, just consider the fact that Mr. Crocker has served as ambassador to Afghanistan, to Iraq, to Pakistan, to Syria, to Kuwait, and to Lebanon. In reward for all of this, he got his current position. He now serves as dean at the George Bush School of Government and Public Service at Texas A&M University. And if Henry Kissinger's old joke about academia is right, the politics there are probably even more complicated than they are in the Middle East. Please welcome Ambassador Ryan Crocker.
Thank you, Jonathan. And as you listen to that recitation of countries in which I served as ambassador, you will have a good sense of my unbroken record of lasting success in a turbulent region. My real purpose here today is to have the honor to serve as the warm-up act for my my battle buddy, Dave Petraeus. Dave, it's great to be here with you. So I hope you were uplifted and inspired by Ted Koppel, because now we're going to get into the really crunchy stuff, the meltdown in the Middle East. The modern Middle East is about 100 years old. The lines literally were drawn on a map at the end of World War I. So if you look back on that century and look today, without question, this is the most turbulent and chaotic era the Middle East has ever seen. It's a region that is not exactly a stranger to revolution and coup over the years, but we're seeing something different. This is the collapse of states. Syria, totally failed state. Libya, a totally failed state. Yemen, a totally failed state. Iraq and Afghanistan are teetering. So what's going on here? I would always warn you against single causes of anything anywhere, particularly in the Middle East. That said, I'll give you one. At the root of all of this is a chronic failure of governments. And you can take that back, again, 100 years. I call it the failure of isms. Colonialism and imperialism. Monarchism in countries like Iraq, Egypt, and Libya. Nasserism, Arab nationalism. Arab socialism, Baathism, communism. Very different systems and ideologies. They all had one thing in common, which is they failed to develop the institutions, they failed to establish rule of law, they failed to win the support and the loyalty of their peoples. So when the Arab Spring lurched onto the stage a little over 5 years ago now. It was in response to the failure of all these successive isms. Now we have a new one, Islamism. That will fail too. Not so much, I think, because of the military might we bring to bear against it, but because it too, in a rather stupendous way, is failing at governance. Its populations are virtual prisoners. So it too, I predict, is going to pass from the scene, but lest you take hope from that, you're just gonna get another really awful ism out there. until, as Senator Graham said earlier, the region is able to develop that rule of law, those institutions that give its people support, protection, and the hope of a better life. But it's complicated. We are not seeing state failure across the board. The states that have failed have been the so-called republics, themselves successors, in many cases, to monarchies. But what about the monarchies? They're actually all doing pretty well. I mean, so far, it's the Middle East. Who knows what happens the day after tomorrow? But the Gulf monarchies, led by Saudi Arabia, pretty quiet out there. Bahrain has been a partial exception, but it's sui generis with its majority Shia population under Sunni rulers. But you know, it's not just the Gulf. Morocco's a monarchy. So is Jordan. Jordan's always skating pretty close to the edge. Rather incredibly, given the pressures that the Syrian crisis has imposed with the refugee flows into Jordan, they're hanging in there. And I mention this again to having set up a single explanation theory to kind of tear it down a bit, but also because it's a lesson in humility, particularly for Americans. We think we know how everything else works everywhere else and how it should work. We heard from Ian Bremmer. Maybe he's right about Saudi Arabia. Who knows? It's a pretty opaque system. But I've been around this region a very long time, and for fully four decades, the pundits in this country have been predicting the fall of the Saudi royal family. Hadn't happened yet, not to say it won't, but there is a resilience there that we might not see or fully comprehend. So as we look at a complex region, before we get to the prescriptions, we need to be darn sure we know what we're talking about. And often in the Middle East, that is not the case. So a failure of states, the flip side of that has been the rise of non-state actors. Obviously, Islamic State having most of the focus right now. But we had al-Qaeda before that, and still have al-Qaeda. One of the originals was Hezbollah in Lebanon, now in Syria. We have seen the resurgence of Iranian-backed radical Shia militias in Iraq. Non-state actors come in two flavors, those that are quintessentially anti-state, al-Qaeda and Islamic State, and those that are, in fact, state-supported. That would be Hezbollah and the Iraqi militias supported by Iran. Sort of an overarching construct here in trying to sort out all of these little hot wars with their multitude of players is what I call the Middle East Cold War. That is Iraq, or Iran, and Saudi Arabia. The radical Shia Islamic Republic, the traditionalist Sunni monarchy. It flows from that the Cold War, and therefore by extension the Hot Wars, are generally denominated in sectarian terms, Sunni versus Shia. That is what you see in Syria, broadly speaking, the Iranian-supported Alawi regime, which is an offshoot of Shia Islam, in a fight with the Sunni majority. There is a lot of punditry in this country that this is a millennial and intractable, unsolvable struggle that goes back a millennium and a half. They've always fought each other, Sunnis and Shia. They always will. Well, it depends on how you define always. Because in the 60s and the 70s, up until the Iranian Revolution, Saudi Arabia and Iran were very closely allied. That was our post-Vietnam twin pillar approach to security. We didn't want to secure the Gulf ourselves with our post-Vietnam hangover, but we could get our friends to do it for us. And our friends were the twin pillars, Iran and Saudi Arabia. It was in the early 70s, incidentally, that the Shah of Iran sent an army brigade to the Arabian Peninsula to help the Sultan of Oman fight a communist insurgency. The Saudis were fully welcoming of that. This was a symbol of strong support against insurrectionists in the peninsula by Iran. So I belabor that a bit just to caution you against buying into too much conventional wisdom that may be conventional but is often pretty unwise. And this Sunni-Shia enmity is one of them. Yes, conflicts are denominated that way now, but it has not by any means always been that way, nor will it always be that way. We probably are not going to have time to get into a look at where things are trending in specific countries like Iraq or Syria. I'd like to conclude by just taking a look at us. To me, it is not exactly a coincidence that a period of the greatest tumult in the Middle East is also a period of the greatest U.S. disengagement from the Middle East since the end of World War II. Cause and effect, we could have a long conversation on that. But what has happened under this administration is a profound departure from the strategic logic that guided every administration since Harry Truman up through George Bush, and that was to be engaged in the Middle East and indeed in the world, that we were the leader of the post-World War II order. We had vital interests, and we had an international responsibility to exert that leadership. With President Obama, and I think this is the true Obama doctrine, he's taken a fundamental departure from that, that we should not be engaged, that we should not try to deal with these gripping problems, that we don't need to lead on the refugee crisis. That it may be ugly, but it's not our problem. To me, that's a pretty profound issue. What is the role of the United States in the world in the 21st century? And I would certainly like to see our candidates have a conversation about that rather than about, say, hand size. So thanks very much. Thank you, Patricia.